ESPN, the world's leader in motorsports television, presents Speed World.
Auto racing, 1965. Second biggest spectator sport in the United States. A year of change, controversy, and accomplishment. A year when the world discovered American prowess. And Americans found out about European driving skill. Auto racing, 65, will live in history as the time when a sport came of age.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dave Despain. Welcome to one of the most interesting programs in our series called The Glory Days. Now, most often we focus on a single race weekend, but this episode is a lot more comprehensive. Chris Economaki of National Speed Sport News reviews the entire 1965 racing season, at least as it existed on television. Things were changing fast in many different facets of the sport, but Chris willingly took on the task of analyzing it all and putting things into perspective. Let's go back to the year 1965.
1965 was auto racing's year of the machine. The car builder, the manufacturer, and the mechanic became important as never before. Yes, there was Jimmy Clark of Scotland, who won both Indianapolis and the World Grand Prix title. There were promising rookies like USAC's champion Mario Andretti, who rose from the relative obscurity of jalopies and midgets straight to the top. But the news was what car builders and manufacturers did. Car builders like mustachioed Colin Chapman of England, distinguished and debonair creator of the Lotus rear-engined look. Or tall Jim Hall of Midland, Texas, the graduate engineer who brought the plastic-bodied Chaparral sports racer into being. But 1965 was also the year auto racing came of age. Purses reached record proportions. The best drivers showed they could win in any kind of car. The walls between oval track racers, sports cars, and stock cars crumbled. Because the machine and mechanic were so important, car design changed rapidly. The Grand Prix machines were in the final year of their 1.5-liter formula. On stateside road courses, the production car faded alongside hybrids, combining throbbing Detroit V8s with sophisticated British chassis. At Indianapolis, the front-engine Oppenhauser suddenly turned scarce. Even where the driver was of most interest, the late-model stock cars of NASCAR, the name of the game was Ford, winner in 48 of 55 races. The United States Auto Club Championship Trail. In 1965, the good ones, both cars and drivers, came in small packages. Tiny Mario Andretti, first rookie since Johnny Parsons in 1949 to win the season title. Jimmy Clark, first foreigner to win the Indianapolis 500 since Dario Resta in 1916. The recipe for both, what the old-timers call a funny car, plus their own steady skill in keeping the car in one piece while going fast. The funny cars, rear engine, low to the ground, with the driver lying down inside like a man watching TV in bed. They spread from Indy all along the championship circuit. Early in the season, there were only a few. New and finicky. The old guard roadsters still had some chance. The big test came at Indianapolis. More than $500,000 on the line, and millions to watch in person or via the miracles of electronics. 46 of 68 cars, rear-engine machinery. A.J. Foyt has set the tone, grabbing the pole at a record 161.223 miles an hour. Second, with the latest Lotus Ford, Jimmy Clark. Dan Gurney, versatile American pilot, will head a three-car team under his All-American Racers banner. The rules are changed to fit the machinery this year. Two stops mandatory, and all must have tanks filled with a special fuel cell material to reduce fire hazard. Jimmy Clark jumped Foyt on the first go-round, and then was to lead all but nine laps to post a race record of 150.686 miles an hour. For the rest of the field, it was a case of trying to last. There is plenty of money for also-rans in this one, and the boys went all out. The pace eliminated Foyt, McElreath, 19 others, but Farnelli Jones rolled in with second money. And Mario Andretti won third place in the 500's Rookie Award. Free meat for a year. For Gentleman James, victory was vindication and a pot of gold he thought he might have won before this. Since Clark went back to Europe and Jones picked his races, Andretti's points gave him the boost toward the season crown. By Langhorn, Pennsylvania, the die was cast. The old guard began its retreat, and Mario Andretti began his rise to the top, riding in a vehicle typical of the pusher look. Most of the funny cars are American-made, but the European influence is obvious. Andretti's Dean Van Line special, a cigar on wheels, was built by chief mechanic Clint Brawner from a design adapted for oval track use by Australian Jack Brabham. There are other similar creations. The rear engine Oppenhauser, created by Rolla Wallstedt. It varies the body shape slightly. And the Shrike, created by Ted Hallibrand, showed still another version of the rear engine racer with the Lotus look. One of the first veterans to make the switch, defending USAC champ A.J. Foyt, is having problems with his funny car. There's a battle of another kind, too. He and George Bignotti, the mechanic during A.J.'s brightest days, are parting company. Since he came back from 45 days in the hospital after crashing his stock car at Riverside, Foyt's Sheraton Thompson Lotus Ford has failed to last in three straight races. After this race, John Polson will come over from Farnelli Jones' car to Foyt, while Bignotti moves his toolbox to Roger Ward's pit. Langhorn, once the most famous dirt circle in the racing world, now changing to fit the machinery, reborn. D-shaped in asphalt. It's the first race on the Big D, and no one knows what the new groove, the quickest way around, is. It is a day of history, for there are many battles going on within one. It is the Ford engine versus the Opel. Henry's hot one is on cars like Andretti. Jimmy McElroy's zinc track burner has a tried and true Oppenhauser moved to the rear. It's Andretti's Ford versus McElroy's Opel, dueling at car lengths. Three-time Langhorn winner Foyt is back in the pack and destined to break down for a fourth time. Later in the season, when he got used to his pusher Ford, A.J. was again the torrid terror of the circuit. Andretti's out in front. The field begins to string out, but McElroy refuses to let the Nazareth, Pennsylvania hotshot loaf. Big Jim is forcing Mario to record speeds. A crash on the number three turn. And fire. Caution flag is out. It turns to red, and the race is stopped. There'll be no record time here, as four accidents will mar the new track's debut. On the restart, the veteran McElroy jumps Mario and goes on to win one of three championship trail victories. But Andretti's ride proves that his performance in Indianapolis was no fluke. Mr. Consistency won only the Hoosier Grand Prix, but scored high enough, often enough, to make his championship run a cakewalk.
This ESPN program is brought to you by Quaker State. The Big Q is one tough motor oil.
How can you stop a throbbing toothache? Massage your hand with ice. How do you cure poison ivy? Try oatmeal. How do you quiet a colicky baby? Run the vacuum. How do I know these cures really work? Because my staff and I spent months interviewing over 500 doctors and health professionals to bring you this incredible book, The Doctor's Book of Home Remedies, from the editors of Prevention Magazine Health Books. I'm Bill Gottlieb, editor-in-chief. And after writing about health for over 14 years, I can assure you there has never been a more complete and practical encyclopedia of home healing techniques than the Doctor's Book of Home Remedies. Over 670 pages, 2,300 remedies, the wisdom and experience of over 500 top U.S. doctors and health experts covering over 130 different health problems. You'll learn how a steaming cup of coffee can stop an asthma attack, how plain yogurt soothes a sunburn. From controlling diabetes to ending diaper rash, you'll find it all in the Doctor's Book of Home Remedies.
Call now for the Doctor's Book of Home Remedies. Try it absolutely free for 21 days. That's 3 full weeks to read and use this home encyclopedia of health and healing absolutely free. Then, if you choose to keep it, we'll bill you in 3 easy installments of only $8.98.
And as a free gift, you'll also get this Meals That Heal cookbook. Over 50 pages of recipes and recommendations on the foods and dishes that can help make you well and keep you healthy.
Remember, you can try the Doctor's Book of Home Remedies free for 21 days, and the free Meals That Heal cookbook is yours to keep. So call now.
In the meantime, use your blow dryer to soothe an earache. Try rubbing aspirin on a bee sting. To stop grinding your teeth,
call 1-800-241-0500. 1-800-241-0500.
Watkins Glen, New York. Midway through the United States Road Racing Championship of the Sports Car Club of America. Defending USRRC champion Jim Hall has his Chevy engine Chaparral sports racer, which is winning everything in sight. Hall's Chaparral is years ahead in design. Molded fiberglass body, automatic transmission, highly modified Chevy engine, advanced aerodynamic styling. Those were the basics. Has cracked all records, going better than 108 miles an hour on the 2 3/10 mile Glen course. He's unbeatable. Well, almost. Back in the pack is a Lotus Porsche, whose driver, Pasadena, California insurance man George Palmer, is beating Hall in the race for the USRRC crown. The rules allow equal points for a class win, and although Hall has more overall victories, Palmer has won his class despite strong fields. Consistency is going to win this crown, and Jim has spent the season so far playing catch-up because of one bad race. The Chaparrals of Jim Hall and partner Hap Sharp are far in the lead, but when they cross the finish, it's Palmer, fourth overall, but more important, first in class, as always. Hall's last chance to catch Palmer for the USRRC title is the Road America 500. The Chaparral is running well against strong opposition. Walt Hanskin's Xerox Special provided most of the competition on the circuit, but there were also a few McLaren Elvers around to keep the Chaparral honest. George Palmer had his hands full all season, as Joe Bezzetta and he provided much excitement in the under 2-liter class. Something that rarely happens in road races did happen at Road America. The race has been stopped. A multiple car accident blocks the track with flames and smoke so bad that drivers can't get through. When the race starts again, Hall and Hanskin renew their duel, as do Palmer and Buzetta. There's always a Cobra up front, and more often than not, the Essex Wire GT40 challenges. When the flag falls, the Chaparral wins another one, but Jim Hall loses his title to Palmer. In 1966, the rules will be different. The big machinery will win, and so will the driver. Another battle between men took place in Dixie, home ground for NASCAR, the National Association for Stock Car Auto Racing. As it was at Darlington, South Carolina for the Rebel 300, so it was throughout most of the season. This was a driver's battleground, a Ford driver's battleground. Darlington, South Carolina, oldest of the super speedways. NASCAR's cast of characters are wheel to wheel, fender to fender. That's Freddie Lorenzen, the leader of the Holman and Moody Fords. Freddie picks his races, nothing less than $30,000. He won the rain-shortened Daytona 500 and will win the two Charlotte Classics, the World 600 and the National 400. There's Junior Johnson, making his final year of competition his greatest. Junior will win 13 Grand National races and is exhibiting the kind of driving that shows how. Ned Jarrett scoots into second in the Bondi Long Ford. Jarrett, the reliable veteran, leads the point race for the Grand National Championship, but barely, over former IMCA champ Dick Hutcherson, number 29. Hutcherson takes his refreshment with him. Tricky Dick's the Holman and Moody point man and wants to make sure he'll finish today. There's a spill on turn one. A car's on its roof. It's Bub Strickler's Ford. You saw the sparks from the metal against the track surface. And there's Strickler walking away, a tribute to NASCAR safety precautions. No number 16 Mercury, is leading on the green. It's Darrell Derringer, king of the used car division of NASCAR. His Merc is last year's model. Derringer finished second at Daytona and is taking the car as far as it can go. But he can't go far enough this time to stave off Johnson or Marvin Panch, another star in the NASCAR cast, and another Ford fancier. Panch, who'll add the two Atlantic Classics to his trophy case, is making his bid. He can't catch Junior. He hits the wall. Panch is out of contention. And Derringer charges back. It's going to be between Darrell and Junior. Now Junior's in the pit. Can he get out in time? His crew pushes him towards the track. There they come across the finish line. Johnson wins by 2 seconds over Darrell, NASCAR says, with Jarrett, who win the Southern 500 here and the NASCAR season title, already lapped. A highlight of auto racing, 1965. And there's more to come.
Serious accidents can cause tragedy, leaving you confronted with disfigurement, permanent injury, and at times, loss of life. During these troubled times, you may need professional assistance. Now, before you sign anything you don't fully understand, call Consumer Injury Network, a service created to help you, the injured consumer. Discuss your case for free with our experienced professionals. You may save hundreds or thousands in your cash settlement. Call now.
It's as easy as 1, 2, 3 to find the right used car with the right warranty.
This is the kind of car I've been looking for. They don't charge extra for the warranty. It's included.
1, 2, and 3-year-old low-mileage, well-equipped Fords, Lincolns, and Mercurys with a Ford warranty included in the price. And the price is right on the window.
This is the only way to buy a used car.
It's as easy as 1, 2, 3, Ford to find the right used car. Exit 10 off 285 on South Cobb Drive in Smyrna.
It's so easy.
Ahead on SportsCenter, Kansas City's pitching Brett looking to join no-hitter royalty. Thumbs down to Raiders' lost art, thumbs up to Bucks' 20th century. And some manly men met the NFL's feared man, the Turk. Mike Tirico, Chris Myers, SportsCenter at 11:30 Pacific.
Sebring, Bridgehampton, Riverside, Nassau. There was one machine which dominated the international racing scene in the Americas, the Chaparral. With few exceptions, others had a chance only when the Chaparral was absent, or partners Jim Hall and Hap Sharp were trying to spread themselves between races and their Texas base. The Chaparral was unquestionably the most exciting car on the road course. Its first test came early, in March, at Sebring, Florida. The 12-hour Grand Prix of Endurance, America's premier road race. The competition is fierce. Although not factory entered, Ferraris are in abundance, with Pedro Rodriguez and Graham Hill heading the list of international drivers. Ferrari's chief antagonist, Carroll Shelby, has a brace of beautiful Ford GTs, which won the Daytona Continental, and a stable of his newly styled Ford Cobras. And as many big-name drivers, Richie Ginther, Bruce McLaren, Ken Miles, and Phil Hill. Also running under the Shelby banner, Dan Gurney will run scared in his personally modified Lotus 19. Against this array of horsepower, there are two Chaparrals. Hall has run fast, but can he run long? Could the Chaparrals last on the grueling 5 2/10-mile airport circuit? The daylight hours are true to prediction. Hall and Gurney chase each other into an early lead over the pack. Pedro Rodriguez in the number 30 4-liter Ferrari is third. Sharp, driving now, is all alone and sets a new race record of over 104 miles per hour. The Chaparral team has increased their lead to 5 laps, fearful of predicted afternoon showers. It's the worst deluge ever recorded at Sebring. Drivers report sitting in water up to their elbows. Hall's car can barely crawl. One lap took 12 minutes. The closed cars do best of all. The tiny coupes find the wet to their liking and sail past the big iron. The rain has slackened and the Chaparral picks up the pace into dust. The Rodriguez Hill Ferrari is out. Broken clutch. Miles and McLaren in the number 11 Ford GT are now second, with with the number 31 Piper Mags Ferrari third after a magnificent stint in the ring. First GT, fourth overall, is the Cobra of Schlosser and Bonduran. In the final night hours, the Chaparral is called in. Problem, no lights. But Hall's crew is prepared. Jim takes the car out for its final run in first place to victory lane.
It's tough enough to take you 250,000 miles. Tough enough to take you from Akron to Atlanta, on to Fort Worth and Fargo.
It's the Quaker State Guarantee. A guarantee so tough, your new car's engine is protected against oil-related breakdowns for 250,000 miles or 10 years.
Hartford to Hollywood.
Enroll free at your Quaker State Service Center. You could run out of roads before you run out of Quaker State protection, because Quaker State is one tough motor oil.
You shower with soap. This is what you're missing.
Zestfully clean. Zestfully clean.
Soap leaves a sticky film behind, but Zest rinses clean away.
You're not fully clean unless you're zestfully clean.
In the tradition of the classic religious epics, Ben-Hur, and the greatest story ever told, comes a new film.
Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Work that fat until it's gone.
The Pope Must Die.
That was disgusting.
Rated R. Starts Friday.
As Chris Economaki reviews the 1965 racing season, his admiration for that Chaparral is obvious, but the ingenious designer, Jim Hall, still faced a number of challenges, and he responded with ever more design innovation. Let's go back to Chris Economaki and the 65 racing season.
The Bridgehampton 500 on Long Island was a different kind of test. The Chaparral must face the man who has never lost a major race in this 2.85-mile trip across the sand dune, Walt Hansken. The king of the bridge will drive the John Meekham Lola T70 Xerex Special, the car which is to register two of the three victories over the Chaparral. Boss man Hall is back in Texas building the 2C, so Hep Sharp will be the lone star in the Roadrunner. The American flag waves down and the international field is off, screaming towards that deceptive first turn where the road disappears and the drivers fight their impulses to go wide. Pedro Rodriguez of Mexico is a surprise leader on the first go-round. It isn't long before Hansken and Sharp move up. They dice a bit and the fans are settling down for a long duel when it's all over. Hansken breaks the rear suspension in the trouble plague Lola. The Chaparral is on its way to an easy victory, and the first big one for Sharp. By Riverside, the Chaparral has tasted defeat at Canada's Mont-Tremblant and Laguna Seca. Laguna Seca was the shocker, as the Xerex Special with Hansken as pilot took both heats, and Riverside looms as a major showdown. Further developments on the Lola T70, the McLaren Elva, and the upstart Lotus 40 was reason enough for Hall to program the 2C. The new Chaparral combined aluminum with plastic was smaller, lighter, but used basically the same engine and auto transmission as the Model 2. It also sported the now movable rear deck spoiler. Hall withdrew the 2C minutes before race time with suspension problems, leaving Sharp to face a formidable field. The first lap accident messed things up, and when the dust settled, the Times Grand Prix found Hansken in the fleet Lola out front for a while. The lead was too hot to hold. Even the big guns further back felt the pace. They dropped out in succession like stars on parade. Hansken led laps 1 through 10. Jerry Grant, out with heating trouble. Dan Gurney, handling problems. Graham Hill loses a wheel from his McLaren Elva. Richie Gintner, Lotus 40 with gearbox trouble. Last year's winner, Parnelli Jones, blown engine. Bruce McLaren stopped early in the race to replace a cut tire. He lost 1 minute and 25 seconds and shattered every record trying to make up that time. When pace setter Bob Bonduran smashed the wall on turn 6, Sharp inherited the lead and never lost it. The race became one against time. McLaren picking up 4 seconds a lap, trying to overtake the slower Chaparral. Between them, 48 seconds and a not-too-competitive Lotus 40 with world champion Jimmy Clark at the wheel. That margin was enough for Hap Sharp. Chalk up another one for the old reliable Chaparral 2. Nassau, Bahamas. Fun finale to the international season. Jim Hall ties his 2C again, backed up by Sharp. McLaren is there too. The rest of the cast doesn't count. The big three quickly take command, and the Nassau surf echoes their thunder. The lead shifts a few times, and McLaren tries to catch Hall. But the 2C wears Bruce out. A blown engine and a game try. It's in the bag till metal meets metal. The 2C is wrecked when suspension failure pulls Hall off course and he collides with an abandoned DNF. But the season ends as it began, with the Chaparral winning. There was another machine that seemed always to win, the Lotus of Colin Chapman. That one machine and one man, Jim Clark of Scotland, dominated Formula One racing's final year at 1.5 liters. Jimmy had the crown clinched by August 1st when he won the German Grand Prix. He was admirably fitted to the small engine formula with his sparse, efficient driving. Driving designed to make good use of all the power available. There were other drivers and other cars. Graham Hill, Jack Brabham, John Surtees, Bruce McLaren, Richie Ginther and brilliant young Jackie Stewart. Ferrari, BRM, Cooper, Brabham, and latecomer Honda. But the Lotus and Jimmy Clark were undisputed champs of the 1.5 liter formula. Auto racing, 1965, was truly the year of the machine.
I'm a big man.
Why do so many men stick with Bic?
I'm a big man.
Because there's a Bic for every beard. Bic regular, a great shave at a great price.
I'm a big man.
Bic sensitive, Bic baby's tender skin. Bic metal, slim head, total control.
Yeah, I'm a big man.
I'm a big man.
Regular, sensitive, metal.
I'm a big man.
Before I switched to Fixin' It, Jones Peanut Crunchies only looked delicious.
Fixin' It and forget it. Fixident is the strongest holding denture adhesive you can get. It even stands up for the hottest liquids. For the strongest hold, Fixident and forget it.
Clark, Iola, Barry, Bonds, Homer with two runners on. Greenwood, Thomas, Nolan, Ryan, Tempest on the verge of flying. Every park, every name, we'll take you to every game. Come back when Homer Mike, ESPN Baseball, Tuesday nights.
This ESPN program is brought to you by Quaker State, the Big Q, is one tough motor oil.
The golden age was building. The future grows out of the past. Clark and his Lotus eventually will have Cosworth power for the new 3-liter formula with Ford's blessings. But everyone starts fresh. And Dan Gurney, the veteran U.S. internationalist, is entering the Eagle, first serious U.S. Formula One car. At Indianapolis, where rules make stock blocks competitive once more, a bigger Gurney Eagle will also try its wings. In late model stock car racing, USAC and NASCAR agreed to common rules, including a three-class system based on wheelbase to weight to engine size. The Chaparral is again expected to dominate stateside road courses, with Shelby's Cobras coasting home in the GT class. Experienced internationalists Bill Hill and Joe Bonnier, who can blueprint every track on the continent, will campaign the Chaparral in Europe. Ford will challenge too, hopeful of revenge at Le Mans after its record-breaking but unsuccessful invasion of last June. Auto Racing 66 looks rosy because of the year of the machine that preceded it. Auto Racing 65 will live in history as the time when a sport came of age.
I'd like to close by acknowledging Chris Economaki's contribution to the Glory Days series. You've seen a lot of him here. Chris covered his first race when he was 13. His paper, National Speed Sport News, is an institution, and he was a pioneer in motorsports television. All of us in this business owe Chris Economaki a loud and enthusiastic thank you. I'll take this opportunity to say mine. Thanks, Chris. I'm Dave Despain. We'll see you again on the next edition of The Glory Days.